All right, it's 2 o'clock. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. I want to introduce your presenter today, Janelle. Hello.
Hi, guys.
This is our graphic designer and photographer, Janelle. She has 10 years of experience, and she's been with Halstead for over 5 years now. Super knowledgeable. So she's going to walk you through how to take quality jewelry photos with your smartphone. And like I said, I'll be here in the background running the chat. So any questions you have in there, let me know. All right. I'll let Janelle take it away.
Oh, thank you, Kelly. So let's get started. Okay. So I know photography can be a daunting task, especially jewelry photography. You're having to deal with shiny surfaces, unlike something like shoes, if you're taking photos of shoes. So hopefully this webinar will make things easier for you. So this is mainly about non-model beauty shots, but the basics can apply to any type of shot you do. And Kelly's already talked about this, but questions can be asked in the chat or on Facebook groups afterwards. You can also email us at webinars@halsteadbeauty.com. And again, this session will also be recorded and available afterwards. So before we talk about what to do, let's talk about what not to do, the big no's. And first off, let me just say, this is my very first CAD piece, so be kind. I know there are some flaws, but it was good to show the differences and what we needed to talk about. So first big no is please never use your phone flash. So have you ever gone to a restaurant and opened up the menu and the food looked awful, like it looked unappetizing? They probably were using a front-facing flash, aka the flash is coming directly where the camera is and hitting the food in front of it. So what happens when you use a front-facing flash is basically it flattens everything out. It makes things too contrasty. There's too much contrast there. And it gives terrible shadows. So it makes food look unappetizing, and it makes your jewelry piece look kind of, it just doesn't look great. You could see all the scratches and stuff, and the stone does not look good at all. The next thing you don't want to do is use your phone's zoom option. So if you get a telephoto lens that you clip onto the regular lens, that's okay. But using the digital zoom, and my phone does have a telephoto lens as part of it, but it still uses a digital zoom. So the problem with the digital zoom is, so if you look at the left, it's the one with no zoom where I got closer to the piece. It looks nice and crisp. If you look at the right where I did use the digital zoom, it looks blurry. It's not as well lit, even though it was the exact same position, exact same lighting. It just looks off. There's what I like to call digital artifacts. So if you look at the pages behind the piece, it has like these weird organic splotches. It's not really pixelated. It just really reduces the quality of your photo. So just if you can, if you need to get closer to the piece or crop in afterwards. Okay. So let's talk about phone setup, how you should set up your phone before you start taking photos. First off, different phones have different features. Androids and iPhones are like the main two, and they really have different features. So you really need to go through what you have and understand yours. What I may be talking about, you may have to get an app or something to get the features that I'll be talking about later. So with settings, first thing you'll want to do is make sure your photos are saving at the largest possible file size. And the reason is, when you, that way, if you start out big, you can crop down and save smaller later instead of trying to blow up a small picture and it ends up looking really bad and pixelated. The next thing you'll want to do is, if you're comfortable with editing though, if you've done photo editing before or you're used to it a little bit, you may want to look at saving in a RAW format. So what usually happens when you take photos on your phone is it automatically compresses the image. So if you have a bright white spot on your picture, when the phone takes the picture, it compresses all of that info down so it's just a bright white spot. With a RAW, if you're saving it as RAW, it keeps the information in that bright white spot so you're able to bring back that overexposed area and start showing the highlights there. So again, RAW format is good if you are used to editing. Finally, you'll want to look at shutter control. So why is shutter control important? For taking clear shots. So I would highly recommend getting a tripod if you were to get anything for your jewelry photography. Reason being is you can set up your photo, the backdrop and everything, set up the piece, set up your lighting, set up the tripod, and just click away. You don't have to worry about adjusting the phone and all that too many times. You may also want to look at getting a remote shutter release. And the reason is, if you're trying to take pictures on your phone, if you're actually pushing the button on your phone to take the picture, what you're doing is shaking the phone as you press it. So that's giving you those blurry, motion blur shots. So if you don't have a tripod or an external shutter release, what you'll want to do, the best two options is something like voice control. On mine, I can say shoot and it'll take the picture. Another one is show your palm, and that one's great for selfies. So you can have the shot set up as you want. Show the palm, I'll do a countdown, and then take the shot. So if you don't have either of those, these ones all in the next few involve actually touching your phone, but it does, what they do is it minimizes or gives you an option to take away the shake from pressing your phone. So burst mode, what that does is it takes like five shots in a row. So the first two might end up having that shake to it, but after the first two, you'd have stabilized. So you should have some good shots after the third, fourth, and fifth. Another one is what's called a motion or live photo. So instead of taking several photos, what it does is take a short video. So then you can kind of scroll through and pick out the best point. Extra shutter button or a floating shutter button. This one's nice because if you have to hold your phone in an awkward way, you can move that extra shutter button to a place where it's easier for your finger to reach. Finally, is your volume button. So this way, at least you can hold your phone easily between your fingers so it's nice and steady. The only problem is you're still having to press at your phone and it'll still give you a shake. So if you can do something besides those, where, like I said, a remote shutter release or using your voice, those are your best options. So let's talk now about location setup. So what I mean by location setup is basically where to set up in your house or in your studio that has the best lighting. So the things you need to remember when you choose a location to do your photo shoot is you want good, bright lighting, but you don't want it to be direct. And what do I mean by direct lighting? So let's think about a lamp. So if you were to have a lamp without the lampshade and put it in front of your piece, that is direct lighting. But the moment you put on the lampshade, so that the light no longer directly hits the piece, the light hitting the piece is coming through the shade. That is no longer direct, it is diffused lighting. So you just don't want the light source you want something between the light and your jewelry piece. So you want it to be diffused. And you want it bright because phones automatically adjust their settings to match the environment. So if you are shooting in a dark room, your phone's going to automatically adjust to make the photo look good, but what's going to happen is it's going to be kind of like that zoom photo where it's going to not be as crisp or sharp, and it might end up being blurry. So you're going to want to think about your background. So as you can see in the photo, when it is set up to books, so then that way you don't really see the background of my house. But if you don't do something like that, you might want to make sure that there's going to be no, you know, dog toys or something in the background. Clean your jewelry and clean your camera lens. You don't want to go up halfway through a shoot and realize, oh, hey, there was a smudge on my camera lens. Just do these things beforehand. It'll make life so much easier so you don't have to go back and reshoot things. Also, clean your photo area and make sure it's clean throughout the shoot. When I started this shoot, there was no dog fur on the page. Halfway through, I realized there was a dog fur. So if this happens to you, it's easier to get that fur out right then instead of having to edit 20 photos afterwards trying to get that dog fur out. So just always check your area. Okay, so now let's talk about house lighting. The first one is with a ceiling light in my hallway. So it looks okay when you first look at it. But if you look closely and compare it to the lamp photo in the middle, you will see it is not as crisp. It is not as clear. And the reason is because the ceiling light, one, is way up above, way far away, and there's no ambient light in that hall. So while it may look fine on the surface, you cannot use it as a large photo because it just is not as crisp. Plus, it is harder to move you can't really move a ceiling light to where you need it. So the next one is where I used just a single lamp. So as you can see, the photo is a lot more crisp. And again, I can move stuff where I want to. But an issue here is you can actually see the reflection of the lamp in the piece. So this is where I'm talking about getting something to diffuse it. You might want to either tilt the lamp so the shade's blocking it. Or we'll talk about this in the future, get a piece of paper to help diffuse it instead. Finally, two lamps. So this would be my suggestion if you had to go the lamp route. Reason is, so if you compare the right image with the middle, it has like that shadow on the bottom left edge where the stone's blocking the light. And on the right one, you can see that second light because it was the first light's over to the side of the piece. The second light's over kind of by my shoulder. So that second light is helping to bring in the light and help light up the rest of the piece that was darkened before. So it gives it more of a better lit image. Now let's talk about using a window. So windows are great because it gives you bright, bright light if it's sunny out. So the thing you want to do, remember, you don't want direct light. And the sun, if it's not cloudy, counts as a direct light. And I'll show you a photo later where I took in direct sunlight. It looks bad. So when you're using it by the window, what you want to do is be right by the window, but just out of the sunlight. So that way you get the nice bright light, but it's not direct. So on the first one, you can see it's a window. It looks okay, but it's really dark. It looks kind of gross on the left side. So on the second one, what I did is move to where I had two windows, and basically it was corner windows behind me. It looks a lot better. The piece is more well lit. But the only issue I have with this one is now you have like two streaks on the stone and you have more reflection because you have those streaks on the stone. So on the final one is window and paper. And what I did here is I was at that first setup where I had the one window to the side. And what happened is I used a piece of paper to bounce the light back to the piece. So that helps, you know, give it better, well lit, lights up the stone so much better. Isn't that a beautiful stone when it's like that? And it makes a really crisp, clean, sharp photo because it is so well lit. Now let's talk about outdoor lighting. So the first one is, you know, you want it in the shade. I did it under my awning on the patio. So the problem with this is if you look at the stone, you can see that you can see where my awning is. You can see where the trees are, stuff like that. So you really want to be conscious of what's being reflected because jewelry, stones and metal are both can be highly reflective. So you don't want to be showing off everything else in the surroundings. So in the next one, the full shade, I move three steps away from the patio. Now that's a really gorgeous piece right there. It's very well lit. You don't have harsh shadows. The stone looks beautiful and you're not getting the weird awning shadow. And finally, like I was talking about, full sun. So you can see the huge difference there is between full shade and full sun. So the full sun, one, it darkens the stone. I mean, look at that. It's just hitting the stone so directly on, you're not getting the light coming back, bouncing back and showing off the beauty of it. Also, it's creating those horrible, horrible shadows. It's like your front flash that I was telling you not to use, your phone flash. You're getting those horrible shadows. And finally, bright sunlight and a bright flash really just, even if your piece is shiny and perfectly polished, it's not going to look so, because the sun tends to basically show all imperfections, no matter how small they are. So just don't shoot in full sunlight. It's not going to work out well. Okay, so here's the best of the bunch from the house lighting, the window lighting, and the outdoor. So you can see how all of these are very well lit, but they all kind of give different feelings. So what you use may be dependent on what you want for your shoot. So you may need to experiment a little bit to see what works best for what you want out of the shoot. Okay, so now let's talk about helpful tips. And this is basically what these tips are, is when it comes to take good jewelry photography, there are three good components to it. You need the light source and its position, camera position, and jewelry position. And to get a good light source and good lighting, you're gonna hear me say this several times, but you'll either wanna use paper as a reflector, or foil is good too. But you wanna use something to kind of bounce the light back from whatever source you have onto the piece. And you can see on the left side with the no paper, there's a huge dark splotch on the left side of the piece. And in the same position where I use the paper, look at how much better lit it is. So now let's talk about light boxes. So that's those huge white cubes you see. And what's good with these is, so like I keep saying, jewelry reflects. So if you're in your house taking a photo, it may be reflecting that dark corner of your room. So what you're gonna, what a light box does is it helps give you like no dark corners, because it's a huge white box just right over your stuff. There are no dark corners. So if you do end up using a light box, just move it over into the sunlight. You need direct light, because this is a diffuser. It does soften the light. So if you are in the shade using this, you're diffusing already diffused light. So with this one, move directly into the sunlight for it, because it's acting like, you know, your window. Now with light position, here's the same shot with two different light positions. You can see how much of a difference it makes. So on the bottom, you can kind of see I did two little drawings of the setup. So the little sun thing you see is where the light was. That huge white thing is a sheet of paper that I used to reflect the light back. And the little gray box on the bottom is where my phone was. So you can see the light, depending on its position, changes the look of not only the picture, but how well lit the piece is. So if you're not very well familiar with lighting, the easiest thing you can choose is doing, if you understand the clock positioning, so in front of your, directly in front of your jewelry, you'd want what would it be? 2 o'clock and 10 o'clock. So off to the side, not directly to the side, but kind of 45 degrees on both sides and 45 degrees up is the easiest solution to lighting that you can do. But experiment with it, because depending on what your piece is, if you have a textured piece, a more angled light, maybe at the 3 o'clock position, will look better than at the 2 o'clock position, because more angled lighting shows off the ridges and stuff better. Okay, so now let's talk about camera positioning. So I keep talking about, jewelry is reflective. It's like a mirror. So if your phone is directly on, in front of the jewelry piece, if you have a nice flat piece of metal, you're going to get a black blob for where your phone is and where you are. So negate that, what you're going to want to do is just even slightly, you can move your phone down a little bit. So that way, you're not getting your reflection. But what can happen then is, well, now you're getting that dark corner in the room. So if that starts happening, you like where your phone is, you like how the jewelry's set up, but you're still getting that dark blotch, what you can do is put a piece of paper or something, use the light box to hide that black area. And so you get the nice, well-lit piece. And then jewelry positioning. So this is where I kind of slightly tapped the necklace. So it was just a little bit more of an angle. So you can see on the first one, it's not well lit. It's a lot darker on the edges. It kind of all looks oxidized. But with that slight tap, now you're getting more of that nice white look. You can kind of see the difference where the oxidation is and where it's not. And let me just say, all these photos until we get to the editing section have not been edited. So what you're seeing is what's been straight out of my camera, because it's the easiest to kind of show the difference. So that's why these ones aren't as bright as you'd expect. Okay, and let's talk about white backgrounds. So a lot of people need to do white background photography for their websites and, portfolios. So what you want to do is get a large sheet of white paper. So paper is your best bet. You don't really want to use cloth because when you're photographing jewelry, it's already small. So once you get close, if you're shooting on something like a fabric, you're going to start seeing that weave of the fabric, the texture. So paper is going to be the best thing to do so you don't have to deal with that. And what you're going to want to do with the sheet of paper is kind of curve it up so it's making the bottom and the back drop. You don't want to fold it because it's that curve that gives you that nice gradient or makes it so that you don't have it's all looks all white. And when you're doing photography on a white background, make sure you use one source type. And what do I mean by one source type? Is either use window lighting or lamp type lighting. Because if you look at me, for example, I have a lamp set up and it has a warm tone, and I have a window off to this side and it has a cool tone. So if you're shooting on a white background, you're going to have a weird mashup of colors if you have window and a lamp. So make sure it's all window or all lamp type thing. So that way afterwards, you're not having to try and color correct it to make sure the gold looks gold. And use a reflector or a light box to make sure the piece is well lit. So here's that piece that I had shot. So you can see, again, this is not edited. I'll show you the edited version later. But you can't see where that curve is at all. So that's why you want to set and also set the jewelry piece a few inches in front of where the curve is. So that's going to make it look nice and seamless for the background. Okay. Camera modes. Camera modes are basically how you shoot, what mode you're in to shoot the piece. So first off is regular mode. This is what you generally open your camera into, and I would not really suggest it, especially unless you're not comfortable doing jewelry photography. The reason being is, and I've talked about this a little bit before, is when your camera takes a picture, it automatically adjusts everything, including things like white balance and exposure. And so that way, your phone may end up taking, if you take three shots within a few seconds, they may all end up looking very different because it's automatically adjusting so much. The next mode is live focus or portrait mode. So what happens with this one is it gives you kind of like that professional blurred background look. It helps give you that nice small focal area. So the only issue with this one is it does just like the regular mode where it automatically adjusts the settings. So finally is a pro mode or manual mode. So this is where you may need to download an app to get all these features. But this is one I suggest. And the reason being is you can, again, set the settings that you want. You can set up your lights, set up your piece on the background, backdrop, and then figure out what settings work best, and then keep those settings throughout the entire shoot. And why is that helpful, you ask? When you get to editing, then you can create a preset that does all the basic edits on 100 photos instead of having you do all those basic edits on each photo. Trust me, it's really helpful. So what can you do with pro mode? Well, you can adjust the ISO, which is how much light is let into the camera. And a smaller ISO is lets in less light. So ISO of 100 you'd use on a bright, bright day. An ISO of, you know, 1600 would be in a very low light setting. And that's when you look at low light photography and see the grain, it's the high ISO is what's causing that graininess. So you generally don't want to go above 400 if you're using the pro mode. The next thing you can adjust is the shutter speed. So generally it is typically something 1/something. So 1/350th of a second. So it's the shutter is open for that short of time. Generally, you don't want anything slower than 1/160th. The reason being is at that point, it's going to start capturing your movement if you're not using a tripod. And also, you can adjust the aperture. So on my phone, I only have two adjustments I can do. And it's the on the second to the bottom one, you can see the f1.5. That is a very small aperture. So what happens with that is that's the focal field. It is a very small focal field. So this is in focus right here. Anything out of that focal field will be blurred. And so if you have a f2.4, that widens the focal field. So then you have like this area will still be blurred, but be a little bit less blurred. So it helps give you those professional shots that you like with the nice blurred backgrounds. So again, this is my recommended mode. If you are not used to it, definitely play with it a little bit, get used to it, because it'll make your life easier if you're having to take tons and tons of photos. Now, here's the differences between the three. So like I said, there's not too much of a difference. It's in the editing that post-processing where the huge difference is made on which mode you use. So let's talk about editing, everyone's favorite part. So I highly recommend editing your photos. And the reason is editing is what takes a good photo and makes it great. And trust me, professionals don't get amazing looking photos straight out of the camera. You have to edit it to make it look great. So I recommend getting an app, because whatever your phone has probably will not give you enough features for what you need. So all of these are free. I've used Snapseed, and that's what I used for the presentation. Adobe Lightroom is really good, and I haven't used Pixlr, but it came highly recommended. So basic editing. If you're don't have enough time, you don't really want to edit, this is what I'd suggest you do, because this is the ones where you can do the set, create the preset, and then apply it to all of them, because these can really take a good photo and make it look really good. So the first thing you want to do is adjust the exposure or how bright or dark the image is. So generally most photos need to be brightened. Next you want to do the contrast. So contrast is basically how different the light and dark areas of the photo are. And you'll generally want to increase this one too. Next up would be the ambiance. This one's a little bit harder to explain. And I believe on Lightroom, it would be the whites and the blacks, which is two different settings instead of one like this one. But with ambiance, it basically lightens the shadows without ruining blacks and darkens the highlights without ruining the whites. So it kind of is a more controlled contrast, and it really can make your image pop. So I'd suggest upping the ambiance if you use Snapseed. Next thing is shadows and highlights. So if you have an overexposed area, you'll want to bring the highlights down. And if you have an underexposed area, you might want to bring up the shadows. But in my case, I actually brought down the shadows because as you can see on the photo I was editing, you can, in the background, there's a few spots that are showing in the dark corners. It's like, I didn't really want those showing, so I took down the shadows to hide them a little bit more. Finally, white balance. So this is really important on making your photos all look cohesive. So if you're taking a lot of photos on a white background and they all end up having kind of like a different white balance, once you look at them all together, it'll be really obvious. So try and make sure all your photos have the nice similar white balance. So white balance is basically how warm or cool an image is. So let me show you these images from the best images from the lighting part. So with the two lamps, lamps are generally warm, so it's going to have a warm tone. So if you look on the left, we need to add some coolness to that image. Shade, on the other hand, is generally very cool, so you're going to have to add some warmth. So you can really see the difference between those two right there. So in the middle, that's a pretty happy medium. That one you probably would not have to adjust the white balance to. And I know it's really hard if you've never edited photos to kind of tell what the white balance is. So when you go in and do it, try the auto white balance and then toggle before and after, because that's the best way to, because then you can kind of see that doesn't look right. Or, okay, I can kind of see how green it is. Maybe I should take out some of that green. Or I can kind of see how yellow it is. Maybe I should add some blue. So you definitely have to get a little bit used to the white balance a bit. So here's the before and after. It's not too obvious. The stone stands out more, but it's the next set of edits, and that's why I always suggest going a little bit further with your edits. That can really make the difference. So further editing. First off is what is called curves. So it looks a little scary, especially if you've never used it before. But basically, it's a graph of the tones of the image. So in the upper right is your whites. In the lower left is your blacks. And everything in between is the midtones. So as you can see on the image right there, I did what's called an S-curve. So it brings up the highlights without adjusting the whites and darkens the shadows without messing with the blacks. So it adds a little bit more contrast. And then the other thing I did is you can see on the lower left, I drug up the blacks. So what that did is made the blacks a little bit more gray. So it kind of evens out all those darks and kind of flattens them and makes it, gives it kind of like that faded look. So what's also great about the curves is you can also edit the RGB. So red, greens, and blues. So let's say your image looks fine, but the shadows look a little bit blue. Well, you can go over to the blue section and go over to the bottom left, because that's where the darks are, and drag it over to the right. So that takes out some of the blues from the shadows. So this is another thing where you're going to have to play with it a little bit until you can kind of get used to it, but it is a great, great option. Next up is a healing brush. So if you ever get a piece of dog fur in your photos, you're going to have to use the healing brush to get it out, because otherwise it is very distracting, especially if someone's scrolling through social media. They're going to be like, is that a piece of dog fur? They're not going to look at your jewelry. They're going to be looking at that piece of dog fur. So healing brush is also great for taking out imperfections or weird reflections that you don't want to show on your piece. And you may have to do this a couple of times, because the healing brush is basically an algorithm. It's looking at the surrounding pixels. So it may accidentally grab something really weird and put a weird part in where you don't want it. So you may have to undo it and try it again. but definitely use a healing brush. Next up, these next two options are kind of similar because they allow you to do isolated editing as opposed to adjusting the entire image, but they differ in their isolation technique. So the first off is a brush. Basically, you brush where you want the adjustment to go. This one is great for basically desaturating stuff like, basically doing things like desaturating silver, which is what I did here. The next one is what's called selective. Basically, you use an eyedropper tool, select a pixel of color. What it does is create a radius of similar colors and tones. So like I wanted to lighten up the dark side of that stone. And so I picked a little pixel there, made the radius a bit smaller so it wasn't taking the whole image. So you can see it kind of grabs some of the shadow of the metal, but that's okay. It didn't bother me too much on that. But it allowed me to brighten and add some contrast to that dark area without messing with the lighter part of it. And finally, masking. So masking is kind of weird to understand, but it's a great, great tool for you. And basically, it applies to any layer that you do. It's not an actual tool. It's something you use with every layer you can use with any layer of edits you do. So after you make, say you make an adjustment and most of the picture looks fine, but that adjustment messed up how your jewelry piece looked. What you can do is mask out, make sure that effect doesn't affect your jewelry piece. So you can mask it out over your jewelry piece. So as you can see in the image, the dark red area is where the effect is being applied to, and the white spot is where the effect is not being applied to. So now you can really see the difference of before and after. So before, it's a good shot. After, that's something for social media. It has more personality. It has more oomph. It's much more eye-catching. So this is why you really want to edit your photos. So going further, oh man, there's still more you can do for editing. I know it's scary, huh? So one thing I highly suggest is applying a filter. So you can get an app, you can use Instagram, but find a filter you like, find a filter that kind of matches your brand and use it. So why do I suggest filters? Because basically what they do is it's an easy way to make all your photos look similar. And they also enhance your branding. And how do they enhance your branding? Well, when someone's scrolling through social media, they'll start associating that look with your brand. So anytime they see something that looks like that, they'll start thinking about your brand. So it's a great way to just kind of, you know, make your photos look similar and enhance your brand. Once you're done doing the basic edits, the further edits, and applying a filter, that's when you're going to want to crop your photo and straighten it. The reason why you want to leave that till the end is if you crop at the beginning, say you want it for Instagram and you crop it right at the beginning, well, you go through, you edit it, it looks really great. It looks so great you want to use it on your website as the header image. Well, header images are generally long and narrow. Well, now you're going to have to go through and edit that photo again because, you know, that square format's not going to work for that very long and thin. So if you wait until the end to crop and straighten, then you can pick and choose what formats you want and just do it right there. Say you want the square. Okay, got it. 16:9. Oh, got it. Save it. All good. Another thing you may want to do is add effects or make an animation out of it. So anything with movement is much more eye-catching for people, especially customers if they're scrolling through social media. So say you have your phone on the tripod, put a backdrop setup, and switch out 5 different rings. Well, you can put those into like an animation on social media and be like, hey, which is your favorite? And then it'll play through and people will be like, ooh, I like that third one. It's a great way for people to be like, for it to capture people's eyes more. And finally, after all that, another thing you can add is copy. So this would be for ads or, you know, engagement on social media, as in you can add in the copy, which is your favorite ring. So Those are the things you'll want to do at the end of everything. But it's a great way to, you know, enhance your photos. So here's some different examples of edits. So before, this is the lightbox one. After, huge difference in color and tone and, you know, brightness of that stone. Beautiful, huh? Here's the white background one that I was talking about. That looks professional, doesn't it? It looks like it was taken on a DSLR. This was all done on my phone. So you can do great photography. Just editing is hugely important to make sure things, like if you want that white background, make it a white background through editing. And finally, this one's a little bit less, more subtle, but I would be more likely to stop and like the after than the before because it has much more contrast, much more color. It pops more, so it's much more eye-catching. So definitely edit your photos. So other tips and tricks. Make sure all your whites are the same color as I talked about before. Toggle before and after as you edit. So every single step, look at how it looked before and what your edit does now. That helps you see how, if you've gone too far or haven't gone far enough. Again, edit one and create a preset. You'll want to do this for the basics, not for like when you go in and desaturate the silver. Just do it for like the exposure, contrast, things like that. And then apply it to the 100 photos that you took. When you do a photo shoot, put it in a separate folder. That way you're not having to try and figure out where those photos are. Oh, I think I took it last September. You don't, that way you're not having to scroll through and figure out where your photos are. Rename your images. This is great because Google can't tell you what's in an image. It can't read an image. So if you name it like waterfall ring, now it knows, hey, this image is of a ring. So rename your images before you put them on your website. And finally, edit on full brightness. So when you're on your phone and you're about to go to sleep and you're editing in bed, make sure your phone's on full brightness. Because if it's not, you're going to overcompensate on the exposure and the contrast, because on the darker settings, it's going to look, your photo's going to look a lot darker. So other tips and tricks. We've had some questions on, you know, how to make stones look good. So like with most of the other stuff, you want the diffused and angled lighting. Angled lighting is key here because an angled light helps, will bounce into the stone and bounce back and create the beautiful contrast that you see. A direct light will just make it look dark because it's not bouncing out nicely. If you have a transparent stone, you may want to think about backlighting, or say your stone is here, your camera's right here. Backlight would be back here going through because then it helps brighten, make that piece stand out. You may want to shoot on a neutral background with those transparent stones. If you have a green stone on a yellow background, it might look green. So you may have to edit it to look blue, or just shoot on a neutral background so you don't have to worry about the color difference. And finally, stone-specific editing. So once you do all those basic edits, go through and edit that stone itself to make it really pop and stand out. That is a great idea. Use the selective tool like I did right here to make it pop a little bit more and be a little bit more eye-catching. Enamel, we've had a couple of questions on enamel. So think of it just like a mirror. And like we talked about before, you want that diffuse lighting. Definitely use a white the light box or some paper and shoot at an angle. It's like a mirror again. So if you shoot directly at it, it's going to get your reflection and your camera's reflection. So that angle will help make sure you don't get that dark splotch. Finally, plan the shoot. This will really help your anxiety if you're worried about, you know, oh my goodness, I have the shoot tomorrow. What am I going to do? Plan it out. Is there a theme? Do you need props? What stuff are you going to need? What lighting will match the theme? What jewelry items do you want to use? Are you doing a new collection? Maybe you're shooting a Valentine's Day theme. Are you showing off all the bangles in your collection? How many shots do you need? Do you just need to show your new collection on your website? Are you just putting them up to sell them? Or do you need 3 months of social media? Maybe 6 months? this is key because it tells you how many shots to take of each setup. So maybe you can set the ring, get the backdrop, and then move your to three different angles. You get three shots for one setup. That's really important to think about. And do set a time aside. Set a time. Put aside time to experiment. So if you are like, I want to do the shoot, get the props, get a couple of props, get a couple of pieces, and test out, like, you know, lighting, how things are set up. That'll make things so much easier, because then on the day of, you can just say, okay, this is what worked. I can do this. And don't stop learning. A great way to learn, like, if you see a photo you like, try to mimic it, recreate it. That helps you teach you about lighting more than anything else, and editing. Watch videos, read blogs. The Halstead blog is full of a lot of articles, great articles on how to shoot jewelry. So I've written one before on how to shoot with your phone. It has a lot of what I've talked about here and some other tips, so you may want to check it out. Another one you may want to look at is how to build a setup for $100. So something besides the tripod, remember I highly recommend a tripod. Another thing you may want to look at is getting an actual photography light. The reason being, so if you're using a window setup, well, what happens if it's sunny one day and cloudy the next? You're going to have two different looking photos and two different looking setups. So at least with a photography light, you have the same look every time. And it's, again, an easy move around. And now Q&A time. So if there's any questions, please feel free to ask.